Okay, so getting to the heart of every painting. These are the different scenes that I've had to tackle in my career, as we've discussed. And these are the kinds of scenarios that have to be tackled. With the full range of every kind of story moment that you can imagine. And so a great case in point, I think, that can really show the challenge and some problem solving is a particular image, the overview shot, kind of the money shot for the movie Wonder Park that we did at Paramount Animation. Just came out a couple of years ago. And so here's the shot. This is the final shot as it appears in the movie. Now, this is not a painting. This is not my painting. It's a huge collaborative effort. Everybody coming together, the VisDev artist designing, the 3D modelers modeling, the texture artists, the lighters, and finally coming to this result. Well, we're pretty proud of this result. And the responsibility fell to me to do the initial lighting and color design to set up this shot. And so let me show you the starting point that I had. So this is what I had to start with. Yikes. I mean, that's not pretty. And you know, they slap this on your desk and say, hey, make something out of it. Now it's an amazing set. It's just an absolutely extraordinary piece of set design. But this is just a raw render, no lighting, no beauty attached to it yet. It's just a grab out of Maya to serve as a layout so that I can use it as a layout to paint over and bring that quality of lighting to. And that's exactly what my job was. And so let me show you where we are at this point in the show. So here's the production pipeline, and we've gone quite a ways by the time we've gotten to this point in the show. So we've done the initial visual development, the characters have been designed, the environments have been designed, the location design, and now we've gotten to the point where we have 3D assets created. We're in this area of color and lighting keys. And so we take those assets and we bring those bad boys to life through color and light. Okay, so I got to work on the color script of the show. So these are all my paintings for the color script. And I know they're real tiny there. This is just kind of to show you the ins and outs, that there's a flow to this, that we have contrast. We try and take you down in mood and then bring you up and take you on just a roller coaster ride through different qualities of color, light, and design to tell you this story. So like I say, I know this is pretty small for you. You can always go over, I have this image on my website, nathanfowkes.com. You can always go over there, take a closer look at any of this material. Okay, so that's where we are in the show. And so back to this image. So, you know, they slap this down on my desk and they say, hey, Nathan, you know, we're giving this to you to really bring this thing to life. We're counting on you now. We're counting on you to do your magic. You're beautiful. You know, we're headed over to the golf course. We're going to take a little break and better be done when we get back. But we know it's going to be fantastic. Okay, see you in a few. Okay, so I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, I got to make something out of this. Well, that's the challenge, right? Our images are filled with all kinds of stuff. And we've got to make that stuff meaningful. We've got to make it engaging. We've got to give it a quality of color, light, and design that not just is engaging to the audience, but properly tells that moment of the story. So this moment of the story, well, it's the introduction to Wonder Park. It's early morning. The park is just about to open up. And, you know, the idea is going to be that the sun is coming through. We have a glorious sunrise. And that's what I've got to come up with. So my idea is we can have low, warm morning sunlight. We can have lots of that morning mist. We can complement the warmth with some nice, cool atmosphere. And we can kind of get a richness from that kind of approach. And I figure with that mist, I can stage this. All this stuff, well, I can break it into layers. and stage those layers with atmosphere so that there's some clarity and some beauty here. And so I'll show you the initial mask I went through. I created selections, and that just means using the line tool, the lasso tool, saving those as channels, and then having those channels available so that I can break this thing up. And I'll show you my initial step here. This is my first pass. So I did that. I went through that. I did this comp. You know, they came back from the golf course. Hey, Nathan, what do you got for us? You better be good. We're counting on you. Well, hey guys, this is a pass. I was thinking, you know, early morning light, and we could do some silhouetting and try and draw attention to the most rich and important areas of the park. So, it's a rough, on a napkin, and let me know what you think about where we're going. Well, they were pretty happy with it. They liked it. They also said, we like it. It's kind of shadowy. You've got it on the shadowy side. Give us about 20% more light in this thing. No problem. I can absolutely do that. And so now I've got to take this to a finish. This particular image, because it's kind of the money shot, it's the glory shot, it's going to be a piece of concept art. It's not just going to be a rough color key. Now, it's not going to be a super tight shot and painting, but it's got to have enough information to tell the story. So here it is. So here's the finished painting to set that up. And if you don't mind me saying so, they were happy. They were pretty happy with how the shot turned out. We got this set up. And so let me give a little comparison here. I'll just zoom in on it or crop in on it a little bit. And so it was quite a while, and the set evolved some from this point. But we went through that entire pipeline process to take us from the concept art all the way to the finish that you see on screen. So this example is not to say that, hey, the solution is to use atmosphere and silhouetting. You know, this isn't about creating a formula that you always go to. In fact, that's the worst thing that we could do. If you develop and I develop a formula, that means we're treating all those different kinds of images in exactly the same way. That's why a formula is not a good idea. It's also why style is important. It can be a little bit dangerous, because extremes of style sometimes mean you're treating every single image you do the same way. It's food for thought, and I do want you to think about. So the point isn't, hey, every image you do, you should use silhouetting and atmosphere. It's that you need to design the contrast of the scene in a meaningful way that's appropriate for that shot. So, well, what kind of contrast then? Well, here's the building blocks of contrast: color hue, color saturation, the values of light and dark, texture, and edge. You know, hard edges, soft edges, lost edges, found edges. Those are the core building blocks of contrast. And putting those things together in interesting ways can really be the make or break of the images that you create. And that is the key to decide what's most important about your image. And we all know the eye tends to go to contrast, right? High contrast, that's where the information is. And so that's what our eye wants to go to. Our brain wants to draw as much information as possible from everything that we see. So we go to contrast. So we put contrast, whatever kind we decide is appropriate, in the most important areas, and we try to get those contrasts to interact together in a meaningful way. In the case of this image, it was silhouetting and atmosphere, and then kind of sprinkling these areas of saturation, you know, in the foreground, in the lead-in with the big sign. We have the, I can zoom in a little bit here for you. We have the lead-in where there's the saturation and hue contrast. The buildings, those greens were very important. The green and cyans on the roof. And then leading us up to kind of the apex here. That's where the contrast needs to be. And then in secondary areas and tertiary areas, we need to really lower the contrast. Otherwise, the image will be so busy that it will lose its sense of purpose. And that's the last thing that we want. Okay. So I'm going to give you a homework assignment right now. And I want you to make a note of this. We still got plenty to go here. And by the way, we're going to go something like a total of 40, 45 minutes for this talk. And then I want to use some time for Q&A. For Q&A at the end, I'd love to have a chance to chat with you guys, answer any questions you guys might have. So you're going to be putting your questions in the chat. I would suggest you hold off for a little while to put your questions in. So I see some of you making some really kind comments and checking in with me and with each other in the comment. Keep that going. I love that. But if you put a question down now, it will well get lost kind of in the back end of the chat. So definitely we'll spend a little time, the last maybe 15 minutes or so, doing some Q&A. Okay, so your homework assignment then, these are kinds of contrasts, but this is just the core. Things like the design of shapes is an interesting kind of contrast. The design of scale, for instance, and the list just goes on and on and on. And I want you to list every kind of contrast you can think of. In fact, you'll probably think of some kinds of contrasts that I will never think of. And because of that, you'll do some unique art. And then with that list of interesting approaches to creating compelling, engaging contrast, what you've got to practice doing is putting those contrasts together in a way that supports the concept of the art, whatever the story is, the mood, emotion, the purpose. Maybe it has a focal area and you really need to bring us to that focal area. You've got to bring the contrast together in that meaningful way. Okay. So, drawing tools. I love drawing. You know, when I... When I mentioned to you guys, I promise I won't go on and on about the eye patch, but it was actually quite a brutal surgery that I had to go through, and it affected, initially it affected much more than my eye. Right now the eye is the only lingering issue. I'm great, I'm 100%, except for wearing the eye patch for a while. But when I came out of the surgery had a real risk because it actually had to do with my spinal column. There was a real risk of paralysis, loss of fine motor skills. None of those things happened. No worries, 100%. But the first thing I did when I came out of that surgery that this whole thing had to do with, I woke up. I didn't say hi to my wife. I didn't know she was there. You know, it was just coming, groggily coming out. I put my hand up in the air and I started going like this. And my wife said, honey, are you okay? She's like, oh my gosh, you know, he's lost it. He's gone terribly, terribly wrong. I said, no, I'm fine. Hey, babe, you know, I'm fine. No, I'm making sure I can still draw because there was a risk of, it had an effect on my spinal cord, potentially. They worried that it would. And there was a risk of a loss of fine motor skills. What does fine motor skill mean? Drawing. And so I was like, oh my gosh, my hand feels normal. I wiggled my toes. Everything felt completely normal. I love drawing. And that shows you what a priority drawing is for me, that was the first thing that I did back at that time. So this isn't a drawing demo, but there's a point that we can take away from drawing. I love sketching people. This is a drawing that came out of my portrait drawing course. We have it up for you at Schoolism. It's an online version of the class. But a portrait is about the person. You're making it about something. It's not about this particular sketch anyway. It's not about the folds in her clothing. Nothing wrong with that. It could have been, but that's not what I wanted it to be around. What an amazing profile she had. And so it's about her face, number one. Number two, well, her hair, you know, their hair was elegant. The necklace was nice. It was less about the intricacies of her silhouette. It was less about folds in her clothing. And so in the limited time that I had, I had to make this not just a drawing. I mean, my photo could have taken a better image than I can draw, a more perfect one, but our drawings can always be better than our digital camera. Why? Because they're about something. They have artistry, they have meaning, they have emotion. And so I made very clear-cut choices in this sketch, in this study, so that it would be about things and not about others. How do you do work that's poetic, purposeful? That's exactly what the answer is. And so you see how very simple her shoulder, her silhouette, extremely simple, because I don't want to pull away from that amazing profile. That's what my image was about. Okay, so let's jump from that to something very different, but the exact same principle applies. I got to do a project over at Disney. I swear, even though it was a home feature. Even though it wasn't like the big epic kind of feature for the big screen, they asked us, myself and the production designer, Fred Warder, we put this show together for the color script, color and lighting design. And they asked us, make it as close to a theatrical feature with your color and lighting design, you know, put the magic in it. And I had so much fun on this show. I had the most fun on this show, surprisingly, that I had had since The Prince of Egypt at DreamWorks. I was at DreamWorks for 15 fantastic years. And then I've been an independent contractor for whichever studio ever since then. And so this was a particular stint at Disney where this show was the story of Captain Hook. It was the backstory of Captain Hook and how Captain Hook became Captain Hook. Okay, so I want to show you the process for doing. I showed you some of the color keys from this show, the color script earlier, and I want to show you the process for making those, because I had to bang out something like 30 color keys a week on the show. Now, for me, that's a lot. For me, that was a lot, and that was like my best speed. And so here's the process. Now, visual development by this point, just like the Wonder Park example, visual development now is completed and we have an animatic. Most of you know what that is, but it's a rough model put into 3D motion. It's like having the movie pre-vised and roughed out with very rough action. And then we can take the movie in that rough animatic form, and I can take screen captures out of that rough, and I can use it as layout, and then I can paint over these roughs, these animatics, and I can use them to paint the final color keys. So I've got to be quick. I've got to know what the story moment is, what the mood, what the emotion is, and then I've got to get right down to that point. I've got to nail that down. So in this moment, these are the pirates, and they've captured, you know, Peter Pan's Neverland, Tinkerbell and the fairies who live there. They have been captured. And so this pirate right here, we'll just zoom in on him. It's pretty rough, but this guy, he's holding a net that he's captured them in. And so this is the key moment. This is primarily what the image is all about. It's nighttime. There's been some magic going on in the background. There's also a turncoat fairy right here, bad guy fairy, the pirate fairy. And so she's important in this scene as well. Okay, so my initial stage then, I've got two things I've got to consider. What are the local colors? Meaning, what are the colors of each object? You know, the leaves are green. The bark on this tree is brown. The pirates are wearing, you know, the pirate striped shirt. So local colors. The next consideration is, what is the lighting and how is that lighting interacting with the outfits and the local colors? And I'm the one who has to make those choices. Now, the characters have already been designed, so I know what their colors are. And so I like to start out with that. I'm going very dark here because I want to add the lighting to it. That's not the right way to work. It just made sense. This is a dark, brooding scene. And so it made sense to start dark and then add the light to it. But I'm getting local colors in. And I'm also starting to zero in on that moment. So I want a little bit of sky back in here so that we have a nice contrasty silhouette. And I already know in the animatic, we've set up a lantern right here. And so that's going to help light up that main event. We're going to have a great silhouette. We're going to have a warm and a cool. And let's keep going. Okay. So from local color, now we're adding some light. And I asked them if they would add in a lantern over on this side, out of view, but there, because I needed additional silhouetting over on this side. So I figured, okay, what do I have to make read? I've got to get the characters to read against the background, and I've got to get this to read primarily. So I'll do a negative silhouette over here, so to speak. This is reading as a dark against a light background, but I'm going to have my characters read as light against a dark background. And that's my very simple idea to get some clarity into this color key scene. Okay, next step then. Well, we've got all of this cool light in the environment, and that rim light on the left-hand side and the warm rim light coming from the right-hand side is going to give me that lit silhouette against a darker background. Okay, and just give me a second here. I'm going to double check our settings here. Okay, we're good. Okay, and you guys just yell, you know, if we have, I did a pretty thorough test on this, but if we have any audio or video problems, you guys yell out immediately in the feed. But now I very quickly laid in the entire idea. And I've done it, you know, with layer masking, and I do have a Photoshop demo for you in this talk, so we can get into some process on how this kind of thing is actually done. But, you know, I've created warm light layers and layer masked them into the characters, and the cool light layer masked them into the characters. And so I've been able to rough this out pretty quickly. Now, we're not done yet. Now we are. And this is the finished color key. And so let's just run through that real quick. We go from here to thinking about the overall idea, the local colors. Now we think about the lighting idea, add the cool rim light, and then give it the proper, remember our list, value, color hue, color saturation, design of edges, hard and soft. Where are the textures? Where are they not? I've given careful consideration to each one of those ideas. We can zoom in on that a little bit here if you'd like. And so it's a loose color key. It's what we needed to do, and it serves its purpose. Okay, so if we look at it in black and white, you can see I was very careful about that setup then. And sometimes I like to throw a noise reduction filter over these images for you guys for purposes of teaching and demo. So you can really see what the sense of purpose is. So let's just kind of blend away the smaller details and contrasts and keep the higher contrast. And you see what we have here. You really see what this image is about. And so I was as conscientious as I could be to make sure this was the clear, simple statement of the scene. And that's how we get to the heart of any painting that we do. Okay, so I had a chance to work on, actually before the Disney project, after I wrapped at DreamWorks, I had a stint doing some shows with Blue Sky Studios and got to work on Rio 2. And so I want to show you, this was one of the key shots we did for the show. And so part of the story is that the blue macaws live deep in the recesses of the Amazon rainforest. They have a secluded place where they survive and thrive, but the fires and the clear cutting is encroaching now. And we needed a shot that described that. And so this is the shot. Well, I want to show you my initial sketch to get this idea going. And prepare yourself, because it actually has some significant problems. There's some real problems in the first pass sketch, and I want to show you what they were and then get to the solutions. Okay, so here was the initial rough, and the setup is reasonable. You know, we frame the scene, we've given the Amazon rainforest, we have the fire in the background, and so we have kind of getting us from here to there. And so I think it's a reasonable setup, but one of my ideas that actually does not work here, I live in Southern California. We have wildfires. We've had some wildfires recently. We're fine here. None of them are getting close to my place, but it's been very familiar. This kind of hazy orange kind of lighting, this yellowy kind of lighting. I was thinking, hey, this is a dramatic moment. You know, the fire's burning in the background and it's encroaching and it's filling up the sky. And so, you know how the sun can filter through that smoke as it spreads through the sky, and you get this creepy kind of orange lighting. We've been seeing that recently here, and I'd seen it back then as well. And so that's was my thinking initially. Also, the director had requested, you know, we show the clear cutting back in here. We have the fire, the clear cutting, and they wanted that in there. Well, looking at this, we talked it through and we agreed that idea of that kind of creepy warm light in the foreground, not working. Because more important than that idea is that the foreground is a place of natural wonder and beauty, and the horrible fire is encroaching on that. Well, we've got to show the beauty and the richness in the foreground and let the fire be in the background. Also, you know, in theory, showing the clear cutting made kind of a on paper kind of sense, but it doesn't have the level of threat. And I really wanted to just light that whole thing up on fire back there. They agreed with that. And so we made those corrections, which brought us to the finished image here, which I think is just a big improvement. So hopefully you feel good about telling how we told the story here, but this was our setup shot for the show. And it goes further than that. You remember when we talked about the design of contrast, I talked about you can't just throw contrast at it. We've got to put contrast together in meaningful ways, put it where it's important, find interesting ways to use it, and then subdue it where it might be a distraction. So you notice the Amazon River, very important here. The blue macaws in the foreground, very important. Fire, very important. That's kind of the hierarchy of what's happening here. And we really need to go even beyond. They're gazing intently out past the forest. Well, that's the purpose and the dual purpose that the river gives. The light reflection in the river lets those characters silhouette and really pop out. But then it leads us right to the fire. And so it kind of serves two purposes. You know, engineers tell you, elegant design, you use one thing to serve two purposes. Well, it's the same in art. Simple statement, powerful simple statement. And so that was my attempt to try and bring contrast to bear in a way that was useful. Okay, so from there, we can go a little bit closer, if you like. And any How to Train Your Dragon fans out there, I'm actually gonna show you the worst possible How to Train Your Dragon image, but I'm gonna show it to you because it's gonna exactly tell us what this idea is really about, and it's gonna solve the problem that all of us struggle with. Have you guys ever, maybe you've done a comp and it was working pretty well. You've been working on a painting. You're trying to bring the painting to a finish. And the more you try and finish it, the worse it gets. Well, you know, you're trying to finish it. You're adding some detail. Of course, you have to add some detail to a comp to make it finished. And so as you do that, it looks worse. So you try and finish it more. It gets even worse. And so you try and do better than that. And the more you do, the worse the image gets. Horrific. I remember pulling my hair out. And yes, it worked. But just driving myself nuts, not knowing or understanding why this was happening. Ever had that happen? If you say, no, Nate, I never had that, it's never happened to me, you are a filthy liar. It's happened to all of us, right? I'm going to show you an image here that will help make that point and show what the solution to that is. So first off, when we did How to Train Your Dragon, the initial movie, the first movie, I got to be a part of that. It's a proud part of my career. And so I got to do paintings like this, under the direction of the production designer, Pierre Olivier Vincent, kind of setting the tone for the show. And so this, you know, How to Train Your Dragon, Dragon Island, and we have the feeling of dragons, and that's the purpose of this painting, to try and make Dragon Island kind of echo that character quality of dragons. Well, the image I actually want to show you is this one. I got to do a little work on, you know, when these shows turn into franchises, we get to do additional side projects. And there was a holiday special as well as TV shows and a whole franchise with How to Train Your Dragon. My daughter's been nuts about the TV show. I won't allow her to watch it anymore because I didn't work on it, so she can't watch it. But so from the holiday special here, this is a finished scene out of the show, but it's a raw scene in that it hasn't had its final polish. Everything is finished, it gets rendered, but there's one more cleanup pass. It's like you take the footage and you can run it through Photoshop. In our particular case, it's called Luster. It's a program, you know, kind of Photoshop for moving pictures. And you can fine-tune what contrasts are a problem. We can subdue them. What contrasts need to be pulled out and emphasized? Well, there are some problems with this image. Let me show you what they are. So if we ask the question, if you had to pick one most important thing about this image, what would you pick? Well, probably most of us would say, well, it seems to primarily be about her. She seems to be number one, if we had to pick one thing. Number two, well, this other character. Number three, well, you know, she's having some trouble, and then, you know, Astrid is bringing her a nice, refreshing hot drink. And it's this nice holiday moment. So what is this image about? Well, that's what it's about. It's this story moment between these characters, and the drink is important. Now, the background's important. This is the setting, the island of Burke in the wintertime. And so it's important. It's just cannot upstage what's happening here. But let me show you some problems. Everywhere that's circled here, every single one of those circles is an area that has too much contrast. Anywhere from just a little too much contrast to, whoa, we have a problem. You know, there's a weird little thing sticking out of her nose. Yikes. Got to get rid of that. There's some little accents and little contrasts and little tangents. They create distractions. Remember, we said this image is about this. Well, guess what? Our eye gets drawn to contrast, right? And so if our eye also is unconsciously being pulled in all of these different directions, guess what's happened? We have weakened our image to the breaking point. And that is why your painting and my painting that got worse and worse and worse the more we rendered it, that's the reason. Because when we did it, rendering usually means you're adding contrast, right? You add some detail, detail has contrast. You render a little over here, you render over there, you render down here, you render up in the corner, you're adding contrasts. And if you aren't rock solid careful, you do exactly this. The more you render, your image gets weaker and weaker and weaker until it breaks. This is a solution. It's so easy, my friends. Easy in theory, not in practice. It does take some practice, but hey, that's why we're here. That's why you guys are going to do the homework assignment that I've already given you. When you render, render in the right places. Give contrast in the right places. Render in the background, render all you want, but make sure that rendering does not upstage the most important elements. And be willing to lose, you know, soft edges, even lost edges, one object disappearing into another. That's very engaging. Lost edges, if you design well, your viewer, their eyes will fill in the gaps. They're smart. And when they fill in the gaps between those lost edges, that means that they're engaged with the painting. They're actually literally becoming part of the process. And then that's when your image is meaningful to them. They're engaged with it. They're actually a part of it. Okay, so let me show you the before and after. And this is very subtle. I just very subtly knocked down those contrasts and added contrast to the characters in the moment. Here we go. Okay, did you catch that? Okay, before and after. Lots of little contrasts are reduced. Look at how the characters themselves become warmer and have more contrast. The environment has less contrast. About the design of contrast, my friends, so much of what we do as artists is about the design of contrast, before and after. Okay, so the title card for this talk, it's about something, Puss in Boots going off to this mysterious location. And I got to do the matte painting. So the foreground is 3D geometry. I got to do the matte painting for the show. So here's a super close up. I painted for hundreds of hours out in Utah. I can do this in my sleep. I did use some photo textures to help me with the bricks on the building. But this stuff, I just live to do this stuff. So that's all by hand, digitally by hand. But it all started with this, a simple statement about this location. Okay, so I mentioned to you guys that upcoming in October, I have a 30-day fromschoolism.com, our sponsor for this talk, a 30-day, 1 hour each day where I provide a reference like this, and then you paint along with me to start off your day, get the ball rolling, learn something. And I just wanted to show you, what are we going to make this image about? And I've already, you know, I'm almost done with the class. I got to be done by the end of the month, so wish me luck. But for me, it's about that church, and it's about the market down at the bottom. So here's, it was about a 45-minute painting. Here's the painting. I hope you like it. And my solution that I'll show you guys if that's something that you're interested in upcoming was to find that simple statement. Start with this reference and to find it here. Again, with this image. And if you go to my booth here at Lightbox Expo, I have this for you in Photoshop demo form. I have this reference. Well, that's an interesting foreground. I have this reference, that's an interesting background. Well, I use that reference and I put them together with a little bit of fantasy lighting and had a lot of fun with it and put this together in about 45 minutes. You can see this recorded live in Photoshop at my Lightbox booth. But I don't want to hold anything back from you here. Let's wrap up with a 3-minute demonstration and then we'll have a little time for Q&A. So I did this rough for you guys. Here's an idea. There's just this big monolith, and these characters have journeyed and sojourned out to it, and I wanted to get a contrast to it. So what I came to was I have the lighting and kind of the snow on the mountain and the moonlight sprinkling across the moonlight to lead us diagonally to this monolith. And then along that same diagonal, I've got the moonlight with the characters, and they're headed along that one line to meet the monolith. And it's casting a shadow, again, casting a shadow along the same line. So remember, how do we bring and get to the heart of this painting? Well, it's putting contrast along that one diagonal line. Let's do it in Photoshop. Okay, here we go. I'm doing this live right now. I'm a very fast painter. No, I'm just kidding. This is sped way up. It's, you know, something like a 45-minute painting, 40-minute, 45-minute painting. But I'm just blocking in some warms and cools on my ground plane, and I'm silhouetting a dark sky. I started out actually facing the opposite direction. You'll see that I changed my mind later, but I'm already getting that diagonal in there because take a look. I framed everything. I decided how are things going to silhouette, dark against light. I've got the monolith in because that's, what is this image about? It's about that monolith. So I got it in there. I reinforced it with this band of moonlight along the ground and then this patch of moonlight leading us up to it. So I'm already right off the bat getting to my simple, clear statement, getting to the heart of the image. Okay, keep going. A little more moonlight back there. And I want to intensify, get a nice cold moonlight in the foreground, try and get some visual interest into it and punch that up, try and get some compelling lighting, get a rim light onto that monolith. So I'm just sprinkling along there, giving it a little bit of an in and out, little variety to the edge, giving it a cast shadow. This is direct light, sprinkling a few things to give visual interest, but these lights still wrap around and point towards the monolith. And now I'm going to sprinkle in the moonlight hitting kind of a snowy mountainscape back there. And I realized I was losing my silhouettes back there. So I wanted more layers. I want depth, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark. How do you keep your values simple and get a lot of depth? You can band like that. Now the characters, real simple, you know, just blocking a simple silhouette of the characters. They've got to cast shadows right along that line. And then they're a little too unique in the image. I need some variety along with them. And I also need to give us a good foreground. So I just thought, I'll just put some dark rocks in there that are also casting shadows. So we're dropping those in, changed my mind about a couple of them. A few of them held, a few of them were distracting. I need more contrast, local color. The characters are wearing rich local colors. They also need a rim light. And now I need to do just a little bit, a little more silhouetting for my monolith. So I'm painting around it, letting that band of moonlight fall across it, just kind of adding a little where it's important, taking a little away where it's a distraction, and fine tuning my image. Yeah, and thank you. I just noticed someone made a comment about my eye patch story. It was quite dramatic. It was a whole lot more in my eye, but like I say, I'm 100%. Except for the eye patch. So thank you for saying that over there in the notes. But that's always my last stage then. Adding where it needs more contrast, but taking away where I've created unintentionally distractions. What you don't put in is just as important as what you do. Okay, and we just about got it here. So I decided I kind of liked flipping the image. There's something about a left to right read, and we do this a lot in animation. When characters are walking through a scene or going on a journey, often we'll play that from left to right. I think the reason for that might be all of us grow up, pretty much every culture now. We grow up with picture books and writing. We learn to see and read and look at images from left to right, almost all of us. That might be the reason for it. That's my little pet theory. But, you know, like I say, it's a pet theory. It's a possibility. I'll let you guys decide. But that's why I flipped it. It felt a little bit better, but that's the process. Whenever I do a comp, that's my thinking to get to the heart of it. Okay. And guys, that is my talk, getting to the heart of every painting that we do. So this is a time to throw some questions into the chat, and we can take a look at that and answer those questions for you. So I'll give you just a second to do that. And if you want to take a sneak peek tomorrow, if you'd like, because there's so much going on, I know there's we're all competing with each other. So go to Lightbox Expo and find the events that you want to check out. But we're doing a VizDev Arts Jam session with a new technology that artists from all over the world, we're going to be painting on the same canvas. A group of about, I think it's about eight of us are going to be doing it. So that's going to be a lot of fun tomorrow. We're going to be answering your questions while we do it. Tomorrow, I've got a landscape painting demo where I'm going to give you reference. You're going to be able to download reference. It's going to be on Twitter, my Twitter account. You'll be able to download the reference there. And then at 2 o'clock tomorrow Pacific, you can paint right along with me during that demo. And then portfolio reviews are on Sunday at 2. Regrettably, I had a huge thank you for the response. The portfolio submissions are closed. There were way more links in over than I'll ever be able to get to. But please check in, because we're going to be talking about, when we look at everyone's portfolio, we're going to discuss this exact issue. How do you get to the heart? You know, your paintings, did you get to the heart of it? And if you didn't, what could have we done to make that more effective? Okay, so let's go over and take a look. Okay, so I'm just going back to the beginning of the chat. Almost got it. Okay. I'd love to hear, sorry, my YouTube link is lagging behind just a little bit, but I almost got it. Okay. Claire B., I'd love to hear how you approach thinking about lighting and shapes for storytelling. I saw the throne room paintings you did for Puss in Boots and wanted to hear more about that process. Yeah, so that's an excellent question, Claire. So I mentioned the design of shapes as a part of the consideration. And that's one of the things that I kind of had to learn the hard way. I wasn't really aware of that at the beginning of my career. But if you think about it, we've got to use anything that we can to get emotion into our work. And if you do something as simple as putting rounded shapes in your image, well, it'll be a little friendlier, a little more comfortable. If it's a frightening image and you have sharp edges, you know, triangles, it's such a simple thing, and yet it'll feel a little more dangerous. If you want it to be very stable, you want the image, maybe you have some architecture and it's kind of that neolithic. That's not what I mean. Neoclassical architecture, you know, like big bank, big monument kind of vertical column architecture. This is going to stand forever. Well, you can do vertical shapes or squares or rectangles to give a stability to the image. And so shape design is such a simple but critical element for designing, getting to the heart of the emotion of your painting. And then you can reinforce those shapes by the way that you light your image. Lighting the image, you know, as you create shapes and silhouettes, it's the lighting that creates those shapes and those silhouettes, as well as the shadows, the object shadows, the cast shadows. So that's an important consideration for your design. Okay, so thanks for that question. And okay, and Ricky is asking, do you usually paint on a single layer, a few layers only, doing studio work? Yeah, some of my friends paint on hundreds of layers, and I don't know how they keep track of all of those. Often you do have to paint on a lot of different layers because you'll work it out, and then you'll get notes from the production designer, from the director, and you may need to be able to go back in and adjust specific things that you've done. And so you'll need, if something is important and unique, you probably need it on a separate layer, or at least you need like a selection or a mask saved out of it. Something as simple as, you know, you've used the lasso tool to select a shape or a silhouette, and then you've saved that. And then you get notes and like, oh, we'll give you know, the sky more contrast and more of a silhouette. Well, then you can go right back and pull those things apart very easily. But I do. I'll either keep my layers in groups so I can see everything at once without having to scroll up and down and find stuff. And sometimes it all gets so complicated, I'll save out my shapes, like the selections. I'll save my selections and then I'll flatten the entire image. Like I just can't take it anymore. And so I can still go to, maybe my character has its own selection. I can still pull it back out, but I can kind of get rid of all the mind-numbing choices and get back to it. So good question. Appreciate that. Okay, so Zedric, and I know I'm mispronouncing your name, but you ask, how do I add more details to the middle background objects to clarify texture or nature of items, for example, trees, while maintaining the composition and not losing the focal point? Okay, great question. So there's so many different ways to do it, but let me give you an example, and then you can just kind of riff off of this. Let's say you have trees, and it's important that those trees have a lot of texture. Really need to see the nature of those trees, but the trees aren't the primary element of the image, just like your example. So you paint as much detail and as much texture as you need in those trees. Go for it, put it all in there. But what you've is you've got to lower the value contrast. You've got to pull that value contrast together. So it's all there. We can see it. You know, I got to, like right here in this, let me just zoom in. I know this is very soft and loose, but here's some textures that I happen to have up right now. And so that foreground tree has a lot of texture in it, but I wanted it to silhouette in this sketch that I used as a backdrop. So the textures are important, but it's very grouped in value. And that's exactly what you can do. Give it one kind of contrast, but group all of the other kinds of contrast. And then you have everything you need, but not to the point of distraction. Great question. Okay, so let's just scroll down and see what else. Oh, and you were asking if this talk will be saved. Absolutely. This talk will be up. I'm not sure when it might be up tonight, but I'm not sure that it will be. This talk will definitely be up and on YouTube, hopefully permanently here on my page. And if I ask you guys a favor, I think it'll be worth your time to go ahead and subscribe. I'd love it if you guys subscribe to my channel. I'm going to be trying to put up new stuff on a weekly or bi-weekly basis here on my YouTube channel. Okay, so more questions. And by the way, we're coming right up on 3 o'clock. I know some of you probably need to jam. There's another event. There's lots happening at Lightbox starting at 3 o'clock. So no worries, but I'm just going to keep going here. And if you want to stick with me, I would love it. So we'll just answer a few more questions and just take the time we need and the time that you guys want to take here. Okay, scroll down a little bit. And hang on, just scrolling up into the feed. Okay, yeah, sorry for the pitch, Michelle. So Michelle was asking if there are any books on composition and lighting that I would recommend. Regrettably, there's just, you know, there's a great chapter here and a great article there. And there's not that much. James Gurney's book on color and light is fantastic. James Gurney has been a mentor to me, and I've had a chance to meet, not work with him professionally, but I got to do the first review of his book and give feedback on that book, and it was amazing. And that's what my feedback was. James is amazing. Before the book was published. So check that book out. I'm going to go ahead and pitch. At my booth, there are links to my book on drawing and my book on landscape painting. And a good portion of those books is about designing composition, about dealing with lighting, about dealing with value and dealing with these kinds of subjects. So if you'll allow, and thank you for giving me the chance to throw that in there. Okay. Blue sunshine. That's a good, I like that. How do you usually decide where to stop adding colors that it wouldn't turn muddy when you started rendering? Yeah, that's the real trick, right? Because color so easily falls apart on us. Color can very easily get muddy. And here, let me just click, because I don't think anyone wanted to see that zoomed in on. Colors can very quickly get muddy, and they can also very quickly kind of get clashy and garish, like too much. They're kind of competing with each other rather than harmonizing with each other. And the simplest way to approach that is when your colors get muddy, look for a little bit of contrast. So they're muddy, it's kind of brown on gray. Well, if it's kind of just feeling brownish, find a cool accent somewhere. Bring out a little bit of cool to give it a little sparkle. Bring out a little bit of saturation in the important area, a little bit of hue contrast. And that's in fact what I'm saying. Hue and value contrast to it. But if the painting gets clashy, oh, you know, it's too loud, the yellows are competing with the magentas. Well, take something out, it's too much. You know, the colors don't have any relationship with each other. And so you've got to subdue. How do you do that? Back to the designing of contrast. You've got to either reduce the value contrast or you've got to reduce the saturation contrast, or you've got to reduce the hue contrast in less important areas. Maybe even you reduce all three of those things. So once again, these solutions always come down to getting to the heart of every painting. These solutions come to the design of contrast and putting it together in a meaningful way and subduing it. People talk about color, you know, the design of color is the domestication of color, grabbing it by the horns, wrestling it to the ground and domesticating it. And that's what you've got to do. And that's what my solution would be. Great question. Let's keep going here. Okay. So Amanda, most artists, and here I need to scoot that over a little bit in the feed. Okay, most artists and art schools recommend getting solid on drawing before moving to painting. For self-taught artists, how do you know when your drawing is good enough? Well, there's this great class, there are these great classes at schoolism.com. And if they're not good enough, we will tell you, no, you know, let's pull it together and here's how to do it. So, I'm thinking about, because I have a solution, but also my solution is more of an advanced solution. And you're talking about getting to the foundation. So as much as I care about drawing and draftsmanship, and I'm hardcore about it, but it is a means to an end. And so what I want you to think about is the moment that you develop the artistic ability to create images that convey emotion. As soon as you can do that, you are a real artist, even if you have so much more to learn. Because I have so much more to learn, so do all of us. We're all going to be 80 years old, you know, and just like trying to get that perfect brushstroke or trying to like, oh, I still don't got it. That's just the nature, because it's such a complex thing. And so in everything that you do, you should strive for that emotional connection with your audience. So it might be the quality of line. It might be the quality of color. It might be the quality of lighting. But that's what you should look for. And so undoubtedly, you already have reference files from maybe images you admire, artists you admire. I would simply say study, do sketches, master copies, maybe keep them quick and short, 20 minutes, an hour, whatever you can do. And practice, because if you say, hey, that's good work, I want to learn how to do it, then once you learn how to do it, there you go. But that's not enough. You got to get out and study from life. For 20 years, I went to 3 life drawing sessions every week, almost without fail. Now those resources are online. You don't have to take my class. There are free sites where you can get references. You know, don't type nudes into your browser, type art school reference or something. But there's so much out there that you can just grab from anywhere in the world and run with. So study from life and then do sketches from imagination. Those three things, from life, from reference, and then see if you can bring it back out from imagination. If you do, say, 20 minutes every day of practicing doing those three things in a year, think of what you'll get to in 1 year, you know, 300 and, you know, I don't know, do it 5 or 6 days a week, give yourself a little break. So 300 times in a year, think of how good you'll be at the end of 1 year. Okay, so that's the perfect question to set up how we can practice. Let's do a couple more questions and then we can call it good. Addison asks, how would you recommend young artists get over the fear of diving headfirst into the industry? I feel that I'm close to having professional quality work, but I'm unsure how to take that. Yeah, how to take that dive. Well, you know, you just got to do it at some point. But I was talking to the Netflix recruiter recently. They have so much going on, and And I had to turn them down. Guys, I want to work at Netflix. And I got an invitation. They have some projects coming up, but I'm already booked. So I'm not going to get to do Netflix for a little while yet. So I asked the recruiter, I asked, I also do some teaching. What would you tell my students? You know, they want to get noticed. Are you looking? And she said, Instagram. She said, not Twitter. It's a cesspool over there. Now, Twitter's fantastic. The artist community, we joked about Twitter. I'm on Twitter. I love Twitter. Sorry. Probably shouldn't have said that. But she said, Instagram, because the artist community on Instagram really is about the art and about showcasing your work and what you do. And she and I both agree, you know, you can and should post whatever you want on your social media. But there also should be a place where you present yourself as a professional who interacts well with people. You know, you're kind, a good person to work with, your work is showcased, you present yourself well and professionally. And she said them and other studios as well, they're going down the rabbit hole of Instagram to look at your work, to discover new artists, to be impressed. And then they contact you and they say, hey, we really like your work. We'd like to schedule a Skype or Zoom interview with you, talk to you, and there might be some opportunities for you at Netflix, at DreamWorks, at Disney, at Pixar, at Blue Sky, and at about 1,000 other studios that all need work, because right now is an interesting time, but the animation and video game and entertainment art field is highly robust. It's doing incredibly well. It's even filling the gap where other forms of entertainment, live action, haven't been able to keep up and keep rolling. And so animation and video games has stepped in because people always want, in good times and bad, people always want compelling and entertaining programming. And so there's something for you there. And so that presentation to get noticed, start at a small studio, and maybe you'll be a bit of a generalist, and then you have that on your resume, that experience, and that experience will be your passport into the next level, and then into the next, and then into the next. So present yourself well and get out there. Okay. Let's see, let's roll down. Okay, so Francisco asked about practicing. And so I would refer you back to the question about the threefold daily practice. Okay, and so let's just look for the next question. Okay, when approaching color and light, do you, and this is Maritza. Okay, thank you for checking in, Maritza. When approaching color and light, do you reference photos or do you play around with colors first with what you know? Both. So we do need to be and get ourselves to a level where we've got it, we can bring it out, and we have some idea what to do. But each one of us, we're only one person. We do not have all the answers. And yet you're doing a project, and the project, there's a sky scene in the sky, and then there's a scene underwater, and there's a scene in a garage, and then there's a scene at night and then at day. We don't know how to do all of those things all the time. And so we have to look for references. And there's another artist out there who knows color better than I do and you do and lighting, but we can learn something from that. And we can reference, and I really like the saying, I've heard it said, milk a lot of cows, but churn your own butter. So it's absolutely legitimate to look at references, get inspired, and even to say, hey, this image, they did something with green in a way I would have never thought of. You know, that concept might work for this other idea. It's a different scenario. It's a different thing. But there's an idea that you wouldn't have thought of that you can bring to your own subject, your own work, your own project, and then it'll rise up that much in level. So here's a little exercise that I do that I want to recommend to you guys. I think we all love movie scores, right? Big, booming, epic movie scores. And I showed you guys some color script work at the beginning, at the top of this. And in the same way that, for instance, the musical score of a show, in the same way that the musical score is meant to guide our emotions through the ups and downs of the story, the color script is meant to do exactly the same thing. It's kind of like the visual score of the show. And so I actually like to listen to movie scores, and you know, it'll take you down to a quiet emotion, and I'll do a little color rough and try and get color combinations that feel like that emotion. And then there's the big booming, you know, kind of effervescent, big booming moment, the big crescendo. And I'll try and do a little color comp, maybe it's just abstract, that feels like that. And I'll do it out of my head. I might look at references and reference files and get some ideas. And I do these little to myself better and better, more and more on being a visual storyteller. And I want to recommend that to you guys to really bring these things together. Okay, so it's coming up on 3:15. I think is a good time to wrap. And I think that's an excellent place to end with, because we started with the idea of getting to the heart of every painting. And we've just had that idea that the musical score and the visuals guide our emotion and connect with the audience to tell the story. And that's how you get to the heart of every painting, is to connect with the audience, to find design, to connect with the audience at that gut emotional level where art and storytelling lives. So tomorrow, I'll see you guys again in the morning, 9 o'clock, and we'll do our demo, 2 o'clock Pacific time, tomorrow, September 12th. Thank you guys so much for being with me. The questions were excellent, and I'll see you tomorrow.